Hello students, welcome to EPG Paathshala. I am Dr. Maimuna Akhtar from School of Pharmaceutical Education and Research, Jamia Hamdard. Here we are going to discuss about the sample preparation for atomic absorption spectroscopy from paper atomic spectroscopy. After completing this module, you shall be able to understand why sample preparation is required before carrying out atomic absorption spectroscopy. What is the relationship between the sample preparation and the method employed for determination? What types of samples are available and are used? What are the steps for consideration before carrying out the analysis? Why proper selection of sample preparation method affects the determination, and how it depends upon the sample available? You will also learn about various techniques used for sample preparation, like dry decomposition, fusion and dry ashing, wet decomposition or acid decomposition, like thermal, ultrasonic or radiant energy methods. We all know elemental analysis of majority of organic and inorganic matrices require the partial or total dissolution of the sample prior to instrumental analysis. Few direct methods are available for the introduction of sample without any preparation, but majority of the samples need pre-preparation or sampling. The major problem in these cases is lack of reliable calibration where you use the direct method. The preparation, on the other hand, allows separation of analyte and makes possible the use of several determination methods. Sample preparation requires approximately 61% of the total time. That means analysis only takes less than 40% of the time of the total experiment and involves digestion, extraction, preparation, etc. And 30% of the total analysis errors are due to the sample preparation.
Relationship between sample preparation and determination method. There is a relationship between how a method should be prepared before using any particular technique. For example, the techniques where direct sample analysis can be done is X-ray fluorescence, neutron activation, thermogravimetry, spectrographics. Whereas in case of techniques like gravimetry, titrometry, spectrometry, electroanalysis and chromatography, sample preparations and pre-concentration procedures need to be done.
The type of sample available dictates the technique used for its preparation or for determination. The samples under analysis can be divided into two categories, which is majorly on the basis of their state. State means in the form. One can be aqueous form, or you can say liquid form and solid form, basically. And in liquid form, you can have two forms, one aqueous and non-aqueous form. And aqueous form solutions are in form of water samples, beverages, blood, serum, or for that matter urine. Other liquid forms can be organics, like oil, organic solvents like oils, fuels, etc. And solid form samples can be from soil, it can be from sediment, from plants, animal tissues, metal, or any plastic. Solid samples contain high proportion of organic matter, for example, plant, animal tissues. Compared to them, soil, sediment and metals have more inorganic composition. Now, before moving into sample preparation, we need to consider certain steps. First, the simplification in sample manipulation. That means whenever you use anything for sample preparation, dilution or digestion, it should be simplified. Use of high purity water and reagent in suitable amounts. That means when you are using water for dilution or your reagents using for preparation of your sample, they should be of high quality. And last but not the least is proper cleaning of the recipient. A blank preparation in parallel to the sample are desirable because that avoids any thing or any signal that comes from the anything that comes from other than sample. A validation of the method is necessary, usually with certified reference materials.
Selection of sample preparation methods. Now, depending upon the sample that is provided or that is under analysis, a method of preparation is used. The selection of method depends primarily on the analyte, its concentration in the sample solution, sample matrix, the instrument measurement technique, and the sample size required. The term matrix here refers to the collection of all the various constituents that are used in making up the analytical sample. In addition to the analyte, the sample matrix includes constituents of sample, which sometimes are referred to as concomitants. The major problem in preparing sample for trace analysis is risk of contamination. And contamination can be from any source, like solvents used for preparation or reagents used for preparation, storage containers in which the samples have kept, the steps of digestion or dilution of the sample, or anything that is used in the protocol of the analysis. Losses are particularly significant problem in trace analysis. For example, container surface may present a significantly large area on which the analyte can be absorbed. At higher levels, such a small absolute loss would have little effect, but when the concentration of the analyte under analysis is small, it makes a big difference.
The method is selected on the basis of sample. And as I said, there are two types of samples generally available, liquid and solid. And liquids can be in the form of aqueous or non-aqueous. So aqueous samples can generally be introduced as such, or you can say directly without any prior treatment, having the concentration in correct range. You can directly subject them for the analysis. You can directly feed them into the atomic absorption spectrometer. The important concern about liquid sample is their collection and storage. Although when coming to atomic absorption analysis, there is no particular concern or precaution to be taken when your sample is available in aqueous form.
So we know aqueous samples can be directly injected because most of the atomic absorption spectrophotometers are used for, or their nebulizers are mostly designed for, water only. So for non-aqueous samples, they sometimes can be run directly when their viscosity is of same as of water. Otherwise, they cannot be used directly. Organic solvents like ethanol or methyl isobutyl ketone fulfill this condition. That means their viscosity is equal to water. You can prepare a sample in them, or you can use them as a dilution for dilution of organic liquids. So the major drawback involves the dilution factor, which reduces the metal content per unit volume. The standards can be prepared in pure solvents, and elements in organic solvents usually give an analysis response similar to that given by the same element in aqueous solution.
In contrast to liquid samples, the preparation of solid samples require number of steps. First and foremost thing comes sampling. Sampling should be properly done. That means you have to properly select the portion or representative portion which contains the particular element you want to analyze. Then subsampling, then you've selected a particular portion. For example, you have collected sample, soil sample, then you actually have to have a subsampling which should be done very carefully in order to not to lose the or have a error in measuring the elements. Then in some cases, grinding needs, like in case of tissue samples, grinding is done to actually release the element. Dissolution is required for some samples. The risk of contamination is higher in case of solid samples because a number of steps are involved that increase the risk of errors, a risk of contamination compared to liquid samples. A number of sample preparation methods are available or are used, in fact. In case of liquid samples, not much is done. A simple dilution is done so as to have a concentration range within the limits of the instrument. And sometimes that can be done by pre-concentration or by simple dilution. You can have partial or total dissolution of certain elements in some liquid that can also be fed directly into the system. In case of solids, normally two basic procedures are involved. One is dry decomposition and another is wet decomposition or acidization. Dry decomposition as such by name indicates that you do not involve any solvent, whereas in case of wet decomposition, their solvent is involved, which is usually an acid.
Dry decomposition, it is usually carried out by destroying the combustible or you can say organic portion of the sample with the help of heat in presence of an ashing aid, usually muffle furnace. The temperature used is 450 to 550 degrees centigrade at atmospheric pressure. The loss due to degree of volatilization is a limiting factor in this kind of decomposition. And it involves the temperature involved. That means at the temperature, whether the other substances are volatile or not, the form of analyte in which it is present in the sample, and the chemical environment in the ashing stage. Fusion and dry ashing, normally used for silicates, refractory materials, or other mineral oxides and iron alloys. In this technique, the sample and flux are mixed and then used to form product which are dissolved in water or dilute acid. They are then heated to very high temperature, which are achieved by flame. The temperature is roughly around 300 to 1000 degrees centigrade. The temperature can be achieved by conductive or microwave also, or you can say digestion can be made by microwave assisted heating also. The examples are given in another slide in table. The disadvantage of this technique is that they can impurity in the sample. The fluxes that are used for mixing may introduce impurity. They also have high content of electrolytes in the resulting solutions and also result in loss by volatilization. This slide shows fusion sample preparation. The temperature required is 300 to 1000 degrees centigrade. Fluxes used are lithium metaborate sodium. Fluxes used are lithium metaborate, sodium carbonate, potassium nitrate, alkaline hydroxys, etc. The crucible used, because the temperature is so high, the crucibles are only used. They can be of platinum, nickel, silver, iron, graphite, or porcelain. The disadvantage of the technique is high content of dissolved solid. Prior to mineral element determination, dry ashing is used for elimination or minimization of organic compounds by its ignition in air or in a stream of oxygen. Additives are used to avoid loss of volatile elements such as arsenic, cadmium, mercury, and lead. The additives for dry ashing sample preparation are: temperature required is 500 to 800 degree, and volatile elements compensation is done by magnesium nitrate. For volatile chloride, zinc, stannous chloride, and other volatile elements, sulfuric acid is used. Wet decomposition or acid decomposition. Oxidizing agents or mineral acids like H2SO4 or HCl are used for wet decomposition of metals in samples in order to have accuracy in determination by atomic absorption spectroscopy. Concentrated acids is used along with heating for wet decomposition. The important aspects before carrying out the wet decomposition include: you have to take care of the acid strength, its oxidizing and complexing power, the boiling point, solubility of the resulting salt, safety in manipulations, and purity. There are various methods of wet decomposition that have been used or explored, namely thermal method of wet decomposition, ultrasonic method. A number of radiant methods have also been used for wet decomposition, like infrared, ultraviolet, and microwave. The coming to first method, that is wet decomposition by thermal energy. The decomposition is done in an open vessel by using heat from a Bunsen burner or hot plate or digestion block, oven or a muffle. No procedure is absolutely perfect, so wet decomposition thermal energy has also some limitations, like time consuming method. It requires large amount of reagents. The contamination from the environment are very high. The pre-concentration of reagent impurities are required, and there are strong oxidizing agents required, such as hydrogen peroxide. And the procedure needs a constant supervision. To overcome the problem, wet decomposition in pressure decomposition containers has been developed, and it was for the first time explained by Carius. The sample and reagent were mixed and the tube was sealed. It was followed by Togl and co-worker and Berners, which proposed that use of pressurized PTFE bombs would work better and will be safe. They will also help to avoid contamination and loss of volatile elements. A small sample mass in addition to acid or a mixture of acids is introduced and pointed out, increase in temperature increases the decomposition. They are especially used for the analysis of trace elements with organic, biological and inorganic samples, alloys, metals and minerals. This is an adapted pressure decomposition which Togl bomb has developed. It includes the parts include cap, a pressure spring, metal lid, PTFE lid, the PTFE insert and a pressure vessel. It is used to actually decrease the loss of volatile materials and improve upon the contamination. The Togl bomb, the apparatus is placed on an aluminum heating block with a thermal probe, a cold water connection and a heating current connection with an overheating fuse. That means if it is overheated, the fuse drops. It gets shut off. In the PTFE vessel, during the process of decomposition, the temperature limit is about 170 degrees centigrade and the sample must contain 100 milligrams of carbon per 35 ml vessel. A high pressure asher was more recently presented by Knapp, which performs decomposition at 180 to 300 degrees centigrade, practically generating carbon-free solution. This was done to overcome the limitation of the Togl's bomb. The scheme of Knapp's high pressure asher for sample preparation is shown here. This shows a Knapp's high pressure asher for sample preparation. It consists of a high pressure vessel which can resist up to 4 MPa of the pressure. It has a heating block which is made of heating element and thermocouple. Inside the high pressure vessel is a quartz vessel wherein sample and the acid is placed. This quartz vessel has a quartz lid along with PTFE strip. The vessel also contains a rupture disc. In case the pressure exceeds the limit, the rupture disc gets off. The pressure inside the quartz vessel is around 10 MPa. This table shows you examples of wet dissolution thermal energy for several ores. The silicates are dissolved by using hydrofluoric acid and sulfuric acid. Chromium ores can be dissolved by sulfuric acid and HCl mixture, and in this case sodium chloride is used to form and remove volatile chromium oxychloride. The pyrite can be used or can be digested by HCl and nitric acid. Fluorides can be digested by sulfuric acid and HCl mixture. Bauxite has been digested by sulfuric acid, nitric acid and HCl mixture. Mercury ores have also been digested by using HCl, nitric acid and sulfuric acid mixture, wherein sulfuric acid is used for evaporation of the mercury chloride. Wet decomposition or extraction by using ultrasonic energy. This is a very simple and inexpensive technique for sample preparation of biological and inorganic matrix source. The extraction effect is considered as being caused by acoustic cavitation, that is bubble formation, and subsequent disruptive action. This can be avoided by sonication of solutions, as it is used to collapse the bubbles, which result in extremely high temperature and pressure. To reduce both reagent and time consumption, a dilute acid medium is normally used in comparison with traditional wet digestion. For decomposition of organic compounds in environmental samples, ultrasound probes are generally employed. Wet decomposition using radiant energy infrared radiation. This technique has been employed for organic and biological samples. Infrared radiations of 1.2 into 10 to the power minus 14 to 6.0 into 10 to the power minus 12 Hertz have been used as it increases molecular vibration and variation in molecular rotation. As a result, heat is generated, which is propagated into the sample and decomposition happens. It requires a small biological sample, roughly 200 milligram, plus 2 ml of nitric acid in small glass flask, which are kept in focus of 3 IR lamps. A voltage of 10 volts for 120 to 180 seconds is applied, and 1 ml of hydrogen peroxide is added, followed by the application of 10 volt for 60 seconds. To avoid contamination of solution, analytes are directly analyzed in the same tube. Other applications of the technique are to determine volatile analyte by heating of liquid and solid samples and preparation of sub-boiling acids. Wet decomposition, radiant energy, ultraviolet radiations. This technique is used to remove organic materials completely, especially in polarography or voltammetry, for subsequent elemental determination. The examples include determination of heavy metals in wastewater or liquid foodstuff such as beer or wine. Small amount of acid with hydrogen peroxide is added to the sample without a significant increase in temperature. As a result, the contamination levels are very low and it also avoids loss of volatile elements. UV radiations produce highly reactive chemical radicals and ozone, which can be drawn away using a laboratory hood. In secondary reactions, those organic substances are degraded, which bind to heavy metals. And then sample and reagents containing several quartz tubes can be arranged around a UV emitter placed in the center. This figure shows you two types of microwave digestion systems that have been employed. One is the waveguide type and second is cavity type microwave digestion system. Another technique used for wet decomposition is microwave radiations. For a wide range of applications, microwave assisted sample preparation is used. It includes decomposition of inorganic as well as organic materials. The migration of both ionic and dipole rotation is caused by the interaction of microwave radiations with sample and reagent, resulting in rapid heating of the mixture with consequent decomposition. The advantage of this approach is that short time is required for the process to perform decomposition of the sample. The direct heating of sample and reagent is involved of minimal contamination and no loss of volatile elements.
Microwaves have also been used for digestion of samples, and microwaves can be used for digestion of huge amount of samples together. And one example is focused microwave ovens that can be used at atmospheric pressure for digestion of up to 10 kg of sample with high concentrations of organic materials. That means if you have a sample with high organic material, 10 kg of that sample can be digested in a focused microwave using normal atmospheric pressure. The tubes used are generally made of glass, quartz or PTFE and are transparent to microwave radiation range, and they can resist pressure up to 12 megapascals. The microwaves have a facility that they can regulate temperature versus time, or they can regulate power versus time with simultaneous measurement of temperature. The temperature control is programmed in accordance with the boiling point of the acid or acid mixture used. On the other hand, conventional microwave oven needs high pressure for operation and rely on the type of digestion flask for the breaking down of sample using nitric acid and other mineral acids. Different security devices have been used in vessels and microwave ovens depending upon the manufacturer.
This slide is for reference. That is, this shows you the boiling point of various acids used for digestion, as boiling point is very important, and boiling point of aqua regia also. Aqua regia is mixture of HCl and nitric acid in 3:1 volume by volume ratio. For example, HCl of concentration 37% boils at 110 degrees centigrade. Hydrofluoric acid comes in 49%, boils at 108. Nitric acid of 70% boils at 120 degrees centigrade. Sulfuric acid 98.3% boils at 338 degrees centigrade. Whereas perchloric acid boils at 203 degrees centigrade. In previous slide, we saw the boiling point of acids at normal atmospheric pressure. However, if you change the normal atmospheric pressure to 7 × 105 pascals, there will be change in the boiling point. So the same acid which boils at 110 degree, that is HCl 37%, boils at 110 degree, will boil at 140 degree. So that means more of a pressure is required for digestion, and that will digestion will increase, the time required for digestion will decrease. Hydrofluoric acid which boils normally at 108, hydrofluoric acid which boils normally at 108 degree centigrade boils at 175. Similarly, nitric acid boils at 190 and aqua regia boils at 146 degree centigrade under 7 × 105 pascals of pressure. So what is the relationship between pressure vessel and sample amount? In case the fat content percentage is more than 75, more than 0.5 gram of sample is required at a pressure of 2 megapascal. And with increase in sample mass, high pressure can be employed. And if you want to use the sample amount, if sample amount available is low, low pressure can be applied also. Present and future trends. We have come across that sample preparation is very important in case of atomic absorption spectroscopy analysis. The present and future trends can be summed up by emphasizing the minimum manipulation of the sample. It means the sample as it comes, we should have a technique as it comes, it can be used as such. Minimum manipulations or preparation should be done so as to avoid all kind of errors. And this can be done by employing following approaches for sample decomposition. One, we can use analysis of slurries, use slurries as such in analysis. We can have a determination in situ and online decomposition technique, and a principle of only single flask, that means no transferring, nothing, because that will actually change the concentration of the analyte under analysis. And automation or robotic is indeed a future trend.
So students, let's summarize what we have learned in this module. We discuss about the atomic absorption spectroscopy sample preparation. That means before carrying out an atomic absorption spectroscopy, why samples are prepared, how they are prepared, what is the relationship between the preparation of the sample and the method of determination. What are the types of samples which are available, like liquid samples and solid samples, and what steps or what considerations should be taken care of before carrying out any analysis. Why proper selection of sample is important. We have also learned about techniques like dry decomposition, fusion and dry ashing, wet decomposition or acid decomposition using thermal, ultrasonic, radiant energy for decomposition of the solid samples. Thank you.